So good evening to everyone, and welcome to Success Story hosted by ABC Accelerator with a guest coming especially from the Silicon Valley, USA, Jeff Burton. Just gonna give you a very short introduction who Jeff is. He's a very renowned person in the, especially in the gaming industry. Started working for Atari, is that correct? Continued as one of the founders of Electronic Arts, and later on established several other companies, has been a manager of an accelerator at Berkeley University, as well, of course, as a Stanford alumni. This creates a strange situation for you, doesn't it? And lately, he has been working a lot in establishing a bridge for startups, and especially gaming startups, between Europe and US. So, Jeff, thank you very much for joining us today here, and I'm very interested what you're about to say.
Great, thank you. My microphone is on too, okay, good. Thanks, Alex. Do we have the sound? Okay, that's a train going by. So I'm very pleased to be here tonight. Glad to see all of you. I guess we'll have to deal with the sound volumes as we go along. And also, I have sound in the slideshow on video. So it won't come through these speakers. I've got a little speaker here that I think will be adequate to allow you all to hear what's being said in the videos. But I want to talk, go back about 30 years. By the way, I have been in lots of different industries, not just the gaming industry. I've been in the ticketing business. I had a printing and publishing firm. I was a co-producer of movies in Hollywood. I also had a number of startups in the sort of era of the dot-com bubble. And I used to hire Stanford students who had just graduated from CS, with CS majors, computer science majors. They always had ideas for what could be done on the internet back in the early 90s. And so we'd start little companies and give them some experience with that kind of thing, and then they'd go on to graduate school or the rest of their lives. We didn't hit any big deal during that time period, but we did maybe four or five different companies. And I also started a hospitality club in Florence, Italy, about 7 years ago at the old Stanford in Italy villa, which was called Il Salviatino. It still exists, and it's between Florence and Fiesole. And so I've done a lot of different things. I've never worked any place more than 7 years. That's one of the things that I think is endemic with among startup entrepreneurs, serial entrepreneurs as they're called. You don't stay in one place too long. I was with Electronic Arts for 7 years, and that's the longest I've been with any company. But I also had the ticketing company for that same length of time. Anyway, I want to kind of go back and give you some background on what I think makes sort of gave rise to the Silicon Valley ecosystem and the way people kind of think there. And it does start, the background starts with Stanford University. It played such a major role in what happened in Silicon Valley that I felt like it was worth it to quote from the founding grant of Stanford, that the universities, you can't really see my pointer, but the grant describes the nature, object, and purpose of the institution, and it says its object is to qualify its students for personal success and direct usefulness in life. Well, when a university is founded with that as its object, it can lead to a whole lot of different results than universities who are founded with the objective of teaching and doing research. This is a much more of a focus on students being able to succeed, and what does it take to make them succeed? Of course, it takes teaching and research, but just the fact that it's that they the Stanford family wanted to have its students be useful in life and successful means that they took lots of steps to make it a situation where you could kind of do independent learning, and all of the programs are focused on the students' benefit. And that also led then to people being able to go out and start companies, I think, in eventually. The Silicon Valley does have, by the way, a legacy of innovation. 1887 is when the world's first mountaintop observatory was built, and that's in San Jose. In 1906, the first vacuum tube was invented at Stanford. 1909, the first radio station in the United States was started in San Jose. 1917, Magnavox got founded in Napa Valley, which is up in just north of San Francisco. Magnavox was the first maker of audio equipment, and is still in business. 27, the first television broadcasting station in the United States was set up in San Francisco. And in 1939, HP was founded. Now, they created this audio oscillator, and one of the interesting things about HP was and its equipment, which was very, very much scientific. Walt Disney took notice of them and was one of their first customers for his video, his cartoons. And so that was the beginning of sort of a joining of high technology with consumer products. Excuse me, with entertainment products. And I would say that was a good start for the whole thing. While in 56, then William Shockley, who invented the transistor, and he and his colleagues won a Nobel Prize for that. He started in Mountain View his Shockley Transistor Corporation. And he was so terrible to work with that the first bunch of brilliant employees he brought from the East Coast, they all left and started their own transistor companies. So that's what started the chip companies. Intel was a spin out from Shockley's company. So was Fairchild. And it was just an interesting sort of a proliferation of chip making companies, thanks to William Shockley's being so impossible to deal with. But one of the things that I always like to tell, because I think it's important, is that the dean of the engineering school, Fred Terman was his name, had a policy that if you wanted to be a professor in the engineering department at Stanford and have tenure, you had to have started a company. You had to leave the university, start a company, and you could come back and become a professor. Well, David Packard and Bill Hewlett, who started Hewlett-Packard, that's their garage in Palo Alto that you can still go to visit, as a matter of fact, where they started the company in 1939. They were students of Dean Terman's, and they adopted the same kind of attitude toward their employees, which was not that they would ever give tenure, but they told their employees, bunches, you know, thousands of engineers, that if they had an idea for a company, a startup company that they wanted to pursue, that they were encouraged to leave Hewlett-Packard and go pursue it. Now, Hewlett-Packard wouldn't fund it, but what Hewlett-Packard did say was that if they succeeded, great for them. If they didn't and wanted to come back to Hewlett-Packard, Hewlett-Packard would keep a job, would always rehire them. They wouldn't keep a job open, but they'd always rehire them. If they wanted to come back. Well, that made it a whole lot easier for a lot of engineers to go try their luck, do a startup and see if they could make it. And if they didn't, they could always go back to Hewlett-Packard. And as I have said before in other circumstances, but talking at Google with some of their executives this, a few months ago, I was asking how do they find engineers because it's so they're so few. And I said, where are you recruiting? And they said, well, you know, as a matter of fact, the largest number that, of people that we hire are former Google employees. So they too have it's this whole revolving door still exists in Silicon Valley as an ethic that, that you can leave and try something else and you can always come back if you don't succeed. I think that helps provide a safety net for startup entrepreneurs in the Bay Area that is that's somewhat unique. Of course, in the 60s, we had the space program. In 72, Nolan Bushnell founded Atari. 76, it was Apple. 82, Electronic Arts was founded. And by the 2000s, of course, we have these billions of people connected. So people have asked me before, isn't it too late to start a company? There's so many startups and thousands of them. And the fact of the matter is the, it's never been a better time to start a company because the market has been never so accessible so inexpensively. You've got billions of people. When we started Electronic Arts, there were maybe 5 million installed home computers. That was our market size. Now you can reach billions of people, which is a fantastic opportunity. I'll jump back to Atari just to kind of give you some insights into it. Let's see here. Yeah, I think that's my next one is, do you remember this? It's not showing up totally on the screen, but, oh yeah, there we go. Does anybody recognize that? That was the first Atari game. Pong. It's hard to believe that in 1972, that this meant anything, this had any appeal. But it did, and kind of started the whole gaming industry, if you will. Of course, there were machine-coded games, and Pong and Asteroids and Breakout. Those were all very popular games. Atari did all of its game development in-house. Their biggest revenues and their first revenue were from coin-op machines. Don't know if you've ever seen those. They used to be in bars and, I don't know, malls. Not malls, because there weren't that many malls back then in 72. But you used to be able to put quarters into machines and play the games. And they were very popular. And in fact, there were so many quarters, I think they were collecting something like $100 million a day in quarters across the country. And the machines would fill up with quarters, and then you couldn't add any more quarters, so you'd have to stop playing. Well, of course, that was not good, so they had to start collecting the quarters during the whole 24-hour period, or however long the bar was open. And that meant that they had to start getting protection from the mafia for their money collectors, because they were walking out of these bars with bags full of quarters. And that was too easily too easy a target. So Atari had to actually hire or get involved with protection from mafia, which was not was an odd piece of Atari's history. They also undervalued their developers. They didn't name them. I don't know who wrote Pong. It might have been Nolan Bushnell. I don't know. I don't know who wrote Asteroids, and I worked there. They didn't pay royalties to their the people that wrote these products. They just paid them a salary and expected them to produce. So the people who wrote these games did not own the intellectual property for the games either. That ended up being a problem for Atari down the road, but Nolan cashed out, had an exit for $30 million in 1976, sold to Warner Communications. And then Warner decided, hey, this coin-op business could be transferred into the home, let's do that. And by 77, they introduced the VCS 2600, which was that game console with a cartridge that you played at home in with. They had computers that they released in 79. Total number of computers they ever sold was 2 million. And in 81, their revenues were about $1.5 billion, which in 81 was a big company. It was probably, you know, that's the definition, I guess, today of a unicorn, if you reach $1 billion in a very short time. And I would say that, 76 to 81 is a relatively short time, certainly for back then, 5 years. And they were over $1 billion. So it was an incredibly fast-growing company for the time. The way they had declined, what happened to Atari, and of course now they're totally gone out of business, and they ended up being just a kind of a flash in the pan, was that they released the home version of Pac-Man, which was one of their most popular coin-op games. They released that for the Christmas season of 1981. And as you probably know, 50% of a company's, of an entertainment, especially gaming company's revenues, come during the Christmas season, the last fourth quarter of the year. Well, cartridges were manufactured even then abroad. I think Indonesia, Singapore, someplace like that was the primary source of manufacturing for Atari's cartridges. And in 1981, they didn't make enough cartridges for the demand of Pac-Man. And so there were shortages all over the country, and their sales force was really upset because they lost, it was an opportunity cost for them, they lost sales, or they didn't get sales, they didn't lose them, they didn't get sales they could have gotten in the millions of dollars during the last quarter of 1981. So what ended up happening was in the next spring, Atari paid $20 million to the the producer of E.T., and I don't remember who that was. Steven Spielberg, I believe, was the director. But they wanted the rights to the E.T. game. There was a lot of hype to E.T. to turn it into a game. There was a lot of hype about it. It was going to be released in the fall of 1982. And Atari was determined to have its video game, home video game, released just around the same time as the movie. The movie was a huge hit. And the sales force, which was, there were sales rep firms across the country, they were determined not to have the same situation occur a second year in a row, which was not enough inventory to meet demand. So the sales force was really vocal with the corporate headquarters about making enough cartridges. Here's E.T., by the way. I don't know if any of you ever saw E.T., the game. The movie was a huge success, but Atari made one guy spend, I don't know, months trying to put together a game, which ended up being so bad that nobody wanted to buy it. Well, it was stupid, meaningless. What is this thing doing? Who knows? I don't blame the general public for not buying this game, especially after seeing the movie. But it was rushed to the to completion, and the sales force had done so much, put so much pressure on the management, that they had in July of 82 about 14 million installed home machines, and they made about 20 million ET cartridges. That is testimony to the fact that back in 1982, large corporations had real difficulty with real-time information for their manufacturing, their sales, their distribution, everything. They were a month behind, always. So you didn't know the results of last month until like the middle of the following month, and they didn't keep fantastic records either. It was such a booming business and moving so fast, and they just thought, well, we'll worry about that later, and they didn't have great information systems, so they way overproduced, and the game was terrible, so it didn't sell. So here's what Atari did. They ended up dumping the ET cartridges and burying them in big underground dumping places in New Mexico and Arizona and across the border in Mexico. And I guess it was maybe last fall, somebody uncovered in a dump all these thousands and thousands of ET cartridges and actually pulled them out of the dump and started selling them online. They actually sold as novelty items. But that was really the decline of Atari, that they never recovered from that. One thing that happened was that despite the lag in time of for sales results and all that the management of the company experienced, the investment market, the stock market, and Warner Communications was a listed company in the New York Stock Exchange. Investors got wind of things even later than the management did of the company. So what happened was that when it got out to the investors that Atari was not going to make the sales increase that they had anticipated or reported that they thought they would hit the targets, the stock price of Warner Communications dropped by a whole lot. Still, Warner was profitable from Atari. They were still growing, and they just weren't growing as much that quarter as they had anticipated. So that dropped the stock price. Well, the CEO and the CFO of Atari both sold Warner Communications stock that they owned about a month before the announcement or the realization in the marketplace that Atari was not going to hit its goal. And that's called insider trading, because they made millions of dollars on the in profit from those sales that after the announcement came out they would not have possibly been able to get. And so that's a felony in the United States, and it's white collar crime, but still they got caught doing that, and that was terrible PR for Atari. It kind of ruined Atari's reputation that its top management had sold stock with the knowledge that it was not going to perform up to speed, and they thought they could get by with it. They didn't have to go to prison because, of course, they plea bargained and just paid back the money that they had, the profits that they had made on their sale, and plus some fines. But it ruined Atari, as far as I'm concerned. They never recovered from it. So how did Electronic Arts begin? It was 1982 in the summer. Before, I was at Atari during the summertime, in charge of international sales of their home computers for Europe and the Middle East. And it's actually 34 years now, but well, actually it was 33 and a half, but anyway. So it was the summer of 82. Atari was just building up all its inventory of ET cartridges, waiting to unload them in the public. And I got a call from Trip Hawkins, who was a classmate of mine at Stanford Business School. Now, we were never a garage company, like Hewlett-Packard. There's the garage in Palo Alto. What we did was we had a Trip was already independently wealthy from his Apple stock. He left Apple and called me and five others together that knew him. Three of us were in the same business school class together, and we met at his home for dinner in July, and his housekeeper made dinner for us. I think I'm trying to remember her name. Edna? Something like that. I don't remember exactly. But anyway, she made dinner for us. And here were the six of us. Trip, who was a Harvard undergraduate and his major was strategy gaming, which he wrote himself. Rich Melman was about 10 years older than the rest of us. Trip was the youngest of us. We were all in our 30s, early 30s, 32 I was. Trip was 28. Rich was about 45, but Rich had been a physics undergraduate at UC Berkeley, but he'd gotten his Stanford MBA. Bing was my age, 32. He'd been a Yale English major and then gotten his Stanford MBA. He was working in the advertising business in San Francisco after business school. I was an anthropology major at Stanford undergraduate and then Stanford MBA. Dave Evans was a Stanford undergraduate and master's degree in mechanical engineering. I thought it was civil, it's mechanical engineering. So he wasn't a game developer either. We were all marketing people. We were not game developers. And we were putting together a publishing firm. Pat Marriott was a woman that, I don't remember where she went to school, but she worked with Tribb at Apple. And so the six of us spent all evening having dinner at Tripp's house, talking about the kind of company we would want to start. And then August, Tripp called us all and said, well, have you had time to think about whether you want to leave your job? And he said, I remember getting the call and I said, well, you know, it's high risk and I'm wavering a little bit about it. I'd like maybe a little more time. He said, well, I just want to let you know that all the other five of us have agreed and we're starting in August. And I said, okay, I'm in. And it, of course, we found out later that he told that to everybody. None of us had agreed initially. He just told us all that everybody else was in, and that made everybody agree to join. By November, we had raised $5 million with three of the most important venture capital firms in the Bay Area. They were top-tier firms, Kleiner Perkins, Sequoia, and Seven Rosen. Now, $5 million was a lot more in 1982 than it would be today, but we had nothing. All we had was a promise that we would deliver six games, we would publish six games within 6 months of their funding us at the $5 million level. And I don't think that would happen again these days, but we were fortunate in our timing because we got the venture capitalists to believe in us as performers just because of our backgrounds. Then we moved into an office building in Burlingame. I'll go through these quickly. The second office building was in San Mateo. The third was again in San Mateo. The fourth was across the street from the third, but that was that entire building complex was our third. And then finally we built a headquarters in Redwood City, which is where the company is today. But we never went through that sort of startup garagey feel. We were always a serious, well-funded company, and partly thanks to Tripp, because he did have millions of dollars from Apple stock that he sold, and he provided us with the seed capital of, don't remember exactly how much, $300,000 or $400,000, which allowed all of us to leave our jobs because we weren't independently wealthy, and we could come start working for Electronic Arts. We all took dramatic cuts in salaries in exchange for good stock grants as founders. So what was it really like in the 80s? Well, primary difference was traffic. There was no traffic in the 80s, or very light traffic in the 80s. Now it's absolutely packed. We'll back up to 83, and what we did as marketers for the for our artists, the people who actually created the software, we tried to turn them into rock star types. We based a marketing campaign on sort of the music industry. We found the guy that did this photograph of the Beatles. He was a Hollywood photographer. We brought him up and had him pose all of our artists. These were developers. These two guys were from Arkansas. These two were from Southern California. He was a Northern California guy. What we did was try to create a mystique around, but also give credit to, the people who actually did the programming. Of course, it was going to be part of the plan was to have it be a good marketing strategy to have these developers build a fan base so that the next time they did a product, they'd have a ready-made group of people that might more easily be inclined to buy their next product. We hoped to be able to do that. The packaging that we created. Oh, and by the way, in March in 83, we launched our first product line, and we had 7 products, not 6. So we made our goal that we committed to the venture capital firm. And we used packaging that was unusual at the time. It was 8x8-inch cardboard-like record albums that were single fold. You could open, you'd open the cover of one of these, like to open out flat. And there was a little pocket for a 5 1/4-inch floppy disk to fit in. And then inside we had liner notes, which were interviews with the software developers. We had them tell about why they developed the product, what they thought they were getting out of it, what they intended to do with it, something about their lives, something about what they hoped people would experience with their product. And so we really pushed that whole idea of building a group of rock stars. We even had a board member of, we brought somebody onto our board who had been a founder of A&M Records. It was Jerry Moss. Herb Alpert was was his partner, but they had A&M Records. He came on as a board member to help us just develop our publishing contracts with these artists, because we based it on the record business. So what were we thinking at that time? And the reason I'm going to show some clips now of that kind of thing is because it's kind of amazing to me when I hear it, and I've got to use this little speaker, that we were able to kind of view or predict or believe in something that eventually actually did happen. We kind of predicted it. Let me show you some things.
To do what we are trying to do, we have to be obsessed, and we have to be a little bit arrogant, and we have to be a little bit cocky about having a sense of possibilities that are open to us that aren't open to others because of our convictions. And if we didn't feel that way, if we didn't even have a little bit of a sense of not knowing what we don't know, and if we were too conscious of the pitfalls, if we were too conscious of the obstacles, we might lose our conviction. And we really do have a sense of really being obsessed with it and really believing that we know how to do it better than everybody else. And that may seem arrogant, but if we didn't feel that way, we wouldn't be able to pull it off, and it's because we feel that way that we're going to.
So I always show this clip. That's Trip Hawkins, and because he expressed what we all kind of felt. And what's interesting to me too is that even now, as an executive director of an accelerator at UC Berkeley, as I was for 3 years, that attitude of a founder is still valid. It was valid 33 years ago. And it remains the same. You have to feel like you know better than anybody else how to do what you're doing, that you have some special talent that's going to make you different. And you can't dwell too much on if you knew, you know, what was going to happen to you, if you knew what you didn't know, you might lose your passion for it and not go through with it. So you have to be a little bit naive. But you have to have this continuing belief in yourself, and it sometimes sounds arrogant. But if you can do it, that's not arrogance. It's just a great prediction for yourself. And so I find that attitude expressed in startup founders today all the time when they apply and get involved at accelerators. Here's a comment about our culture.
Provide a world where the rules are open-ended, where if you're flying around the planet and decide to take off toward that star, you can.
We can evoke in people a sense of, wonder, curiosity, intrigue, maybe a little smile for a grandson who learned how to do something on a grandfather's machine.
I'd like to write some software that interacts with you in a way that's really close to the way a person would interact with you. You may become attached to some of the software characters, and you may develop emotional feelings about some of the personalities in the software That's why I've been mentioning the idea of a software friend. And that sort of should be built into a computer, but it can be built into a program too.
A lot of good designs just cause you to smile. I mean, you look at it and you want to smile.
So back in 83, we didn't have internet. Nobody was talking about a software friend. Machines, home computers were seen as being pretty useless, except for maybe word processing, spreadsheets, because they existed. And that's what people were using them for, but they didn't have an emotional attachment to their computers in general. So what we were trying to do was create experiences with a computer that would form an emotional bond with the person using it, and when I haven't heard many people in '83 who were talking like Bill Budge was just talking about building into a computer something that. A way of interacting with you that more like a person would interact with you. We did get to that point, of course. Structure.
Started things and it's just settling down. How this business is really going to be run and organized is, I think Electronic Arts is going to be one of the leaders because of the professionalism of the people that are planning the organization and doing a lot of thinking about the structure of the artist relative to the producer inside the company, relative to the production and distribution aspects all being, integrated into one package. It's more or less where the thinking's got to be. It used to be just a guy in his garage can start selling. And that's still true today to some extent. But it doesn't go very far. A bunch can tell you, you can try that and you get your family involved in working on it. But in the end, you really need to understand how to market the product as well as develop it.
So one of the things I think interesting about Steve Wozniak's comments, he was a board member and an investor, was that it's kind of gone full circle. Back then, yes, you could start a game software company in your own home, get your family involved, distribute it locally. But if you didn't do the marketing, it was very difficult for it to follow, to take off. Then it got so expensive, it was like making a movie and you needed teams of people to do a great piece of gaming software. And now I'd say we've gone full circle, we're back to the point with mobile apps that you can do it at home again. You can create one on your own, and if you're lucky enough to have something like Angry Birds or some of the other ones that I don't even know about that are really popular that were done by individuals, and you have the distribution capability to do it yourself. Just sign up with the App Store, iTunes, or whatever. As it's turning out now, there are so many of those that you have to put marketing strength behind those even now. But we've gone through this couple of cycles. Certainly, we were at the point back then when we had to do a lot of strong marketing to get the products to sell through.
Parents want products that have educational value, but products that their children are going to want to use. Kids that are interested in computing, they want products that are fantastically entertaining and exciting and compelling. And that's really the major part of the market.
We're focusing on younger people, and education is the most important thing in their lives. And entertainment is the most interesting thing, and it's usually diverging from education. All of a sudden with computers, we've got technology marrying the two together in a way that might be very productive.
Okay, the reason I think this is an interesting clip is because this is the one thing we were not ever able to do at Electronic Arts, and that is really combine education and entertainment. I think it probably has to do with the fact that until the advent of the iPad, schools just didn't have the resources to give a computer, a laptop or a desktop, to every student. They had computer labs, but that's not the same thing. They couldn't build their classwork around a computer because people didn't have access. And we tried a lot of different times to get into the entertainment and education side of the business, and we just couldn't ever figure out how to do it. I think it's crucial because that's part of what's going to have to happen with education now going forward, I think, in the next few years. I've seen, there's a friend of mine from 35 years ago in the Netherlands that has started what he calls the Steve Jobs schools, and they are pre-K through sixth grade public schools that use the iPad as their sole source of curriculum. And they're government sponsored. It's sort of like what we'd have called magnet schools in the US, which is parents get to choose if they want their students to be enrolled in those. He's been at it 2 years. There's about 25 public schools in the Netherlands. They're expanding already. The South Africa is opened this month. Is it still January? Yeah, this month. They're opening, I think, 4 schools in Cape Town using this same structure. It is revolutionary to the education system, and it's finally combining learning with playing games. Games can be extremely beneficial to young people to learn how to add and to do math, to build things, to write. We could never do that at Electronic Arts, so it's interesting to see that now it's starting to be possible. Oh, but here is what we always wanted to have when we started. And that is this was our dream, was to be able to produce a game that felt so realistic that you know, we had great animation and movement. When we first started, we were only able to do little stick figures. And by the late 90s and early 2000s, of course, we did John Madden football and FIFA football, which was, I would say, epitomizes what it was we started the company to try to do. It only took us 30 years to get there, but we stuck with it. And I think it's we've really managed to achieve something that changed the way people thought about entertainment industry, as you know, not only from the fact that it's a larger industry now than the movie industry, but anyway, so I would say that FIFA football is a great example of how we wanted things to be back in the 80s, 30 years ago. Oh, and the next thing I show this, that is I, unfortunately. One of the companies that we had at the accelerator did body scans. So you'd stand still and they'd do a full body scan. And what they did was then they'd print out a statue, full color statue of you, which has become very popular. But they could also animate, here I am again, unfortunately. You know, in about 5 minutes after doing the scan of me, they had me animated doing this kind of dance. To me, this is the indicator that the next stage of video games will be able to, you'll be able to put yourself in, with just a body scan, you'll be able to put yourself into a FIFA football game and play with any teammates you want to. That's where this is, I think, heading, so you can personalize the games. This is just kind of silly, but there's another one that, yeah, I could never do that. Looks like I have a hole in my pants, but I don't. Yeah. Anyway, I think that's where games are heading. Now, I'm not going to be too much longer, but there are some things that we did to build a company culture at Electronic Arts that I thought were worth sharing, and I think that building a culture has been important to us. And is important to any company. One of the things we did, which seems a little bit crazy now, but until we had about 100 employees, every current employee had an interview with every job applicant that we had for the company, no matter what level it was. We hired, in our second year, we hired our VP of sales, a new VP of sales. Our first one didn't work out. It turned out that he is now chairman of the board of Electronic Arts and became the CEO when Trip left, and he's been there for 31 years. But everybody in the company interviewed him. And when we were hiring people for the warehouse, working in the warehouse to fulfill our shipping and all that stuff, everybody in the company interviewed the warehouse applicant. And so it became really cumbersome. It would take an applicant sometimes 3 or 4 weeks to go through all the interviews of people in the company. And so we stopped doing that after a while. But what it did was build this, it was actually it was a win-win, because the people that were doing the interviewing, the employees, they didn't have a long time to interview, but they had to fill out a little form making comments about the person that they were interviewing. They didn't have the ability to veto anyone. Only executives could do that. But the fact that they got to meet and talk with every applicant, no matter where, how high level or low level, made them feel like they were really participating in the company's growth and forming the company the way it was coming. And the applicant, him or herself, after going through 97 interviews and 3 or 4 weeks, they felt like they must be the best person in the world if they got the job offer. And probably would have anyway, but still, it really made them feel like, wow, I've been interviewed by every person in this company, and I made it through. They hired me. So they really, it ended up being a positive thing in our early days that we did this process. We also had plenty of Nerf battles. you know, during the day, maybe once or twice a week, a Nerf war would break out. Totally unplanned. Some people, as you'll see, were sitting at their desks trying to work, while a bunch of other people were running around shooting Nerf guns, throwing Nerf balls. And it would be a short battle, maybe 10 minutes. People get tired of doing it and they'd go back to work. But it was just sort of a release tension, because as is always the case in a startup company, there is a lot of tension at all times. People are under a lot of stress. So that was one of the ways that we tried to help people release that stress. We always had a Friday meeting. We'd provide beer and wine and socialize. But also at the Friday meeting, the executives of the company would all stand up in front of everybody. And we, you know, certainly had this many people in company meetings when we were still at the 150 or so person level. And we'd have to, the executives every week would have to tell what they accomplished, what their groups accomplished, what their plans were, and make some comments about that. Every new employee had to introduce him or herself at that point. And anybody in the company could ask any question they wanted to. And so the ethic at Electronic Arts, and was led by Trip as our leader, he wanted us to be as transparent as we possibly can. He always felt like that it was better to give everybody in the company too much information rather than too little. So he wasn't worried about giving out too much information. And it was a way, it was really a powerful bonding experience. And sometimes the beer and wine would keep flowing until late in the night, and we sometimes got into trouble with that too, but it was a really good experience. And a few months ago when I was at Google again, we walked by a room and the guy I was with said, oh, that's where once a month, Larry and Sergey get up in front of it was an auditorium, in front of everybody that wants to come from the company, and people can ask questions of them. And I thought, that's interesting. We used to do that 30 years ago, and it's just sort of I know that happens at Facebook too. What's his face gets up there and answers questions from all of his employees or any that want to ask. So that's sort of an ethic that we didn't start that, but that's the way companies, even when they get big, work in Silicon Valley. But it helps build a culture. We'd also rent out full theaters when some movie would come up that would be released that we felt like was important for all of our employees to see, just for cultural purposes, you know, to keep abreast of the kind of movie stuff that was happening. Star Wars was another one. We take the whole company to the theater and all see it at once. Now, what happens, now that companies all have campuses, each one of them has a big movie theater inside on the campus, so they can show first run films to any of their employees that they want to. That's gotten to be sort of a regular thing, like having a workout gym on the campus, and having food on the campus, and having cleaning and laundry and stuff. But they also have big theaters with big screens that they can show movies at. We had to rent out theaters back then. We also had such a bunch of talented people in our producers of what we call producers of products. A lot of them came from the music industry, and so at one point in 1986, a bunch of the producers said, "Look, we'd like to create an album of covers from current songs, and we'll write the lyrics to them, and we want everybody in the company to perform them." Well, we took about 2 days in total, and everybody in the company had to participate and sing these stupid songs. But anyway, this is just, I'll be quick with this, but you can see the lyrics were making fun of the company. This is not part of it, but in a second you'll. So you can see from the photos, and some of them will go through the photos, that everybody was at a microphone at some point singing these lyrics. So we were making fun of, all the songs were making fun of Electronic Arts. And it was just a way of, we had probably 250 people in the company at that time, and it was a way of creating some bonds and not taking ourselves too seriously. But we had a bunch of talented music producers in that era. We still didn't escape all the hard stuff. After 9 years, all but one of us was gone. All were gone, sorry. Within the first year, two people were fired. Two of the founders were fired by Trip. The fourth year, another founder left because it was just too much pressure. It got to him, he couldn't stand it any longer. In the seventh year, after we went public, I left. Because I had a young family and I wanted to spend time with the family, and I was traveling. I was international director of international marketing, and so I was traveling over 50% of my time, and I had young kids and wanted to spend time with them. In year nine, Trip left because he wanted to start his own company that would produce a piece of hardware. It was called 3DO. He wanted to produce a hardware-based game machine that could perform in all the ways that computers still couldn't. He wanted to use CDs as the medium. Computers were still using 1.5-inch floppy disks, something like that. Anyway, he left after 9 years. And as I said, Bing or I haven't said that, but Bing was the only one of our founders that stayed for about 27 years. Bing is now at Kleiner Perkins as a venture capitalist, but only one of us was around then. You know, the Rockstar game programming thing didn't really work. It gave us a good start, but we couldn't sustain that, mostly because it turned out that the programmers only had one or two, maybe three games in them. That was all. It wasn't like they were turning out games like musicians turn out music. You know, once a year, maybe releasing an album, maybe once every 2 years, and that has, you know, whatever, 12, 15 songs on it. The video game producers weren't that prolific, so they just couldn't build a fan base. And they couldn't produce the kind of software that was needed after a while, because the hardware got more sophisticated, you needed better tools, you needed to start having whole graphics teams, whole musical teams, analysts, if we will, for action and production values that they just couldn't have on their own. So we eventually turned everything in-house. We thought at one time we were going to have to produce productivity software for the home. We bought a company that made a all-in-one productivity piece of software. We called it Get Organized. It had a calendar, a database, a spreadsheet, a word processor. I don't remember what else. We spent millions of dollars and wasted it. We couldn't do it. We couldn't make it fly. We got a guy from Harvard to come in and be the product manager for it. We threw advertising after. We did packaging fantastically. It wouldn't sell. We could not sell it through. So we had to just write that off. We had to start distributing other people's games. We never thought we'd do that. Because we wanted to maintain our quality, and yet we created our own sales force, which was an unusual thing to do at that time for video games. And then we didn't have enough product to supply them, so we started having to go to other competitors, if you will, publishing houses, and suggest that we distribute their software along with ours. Well, it turned out that kind of saved the company at one point. As I said, games got so complex, it took years and big teams and millions of dollars to produce. And then we had the internet come along in 1996. Well, the internet was not friendly to Electronic Arts' business model, because there was no way, we had products that were sophisticated enough in 1996 that there was no way you could download them with a 14.4K baud modem. It would take days and days. So we really, Electronic Arts still hasn't mastered the internet, I don't think. Still hasn't been able to exploit the internet to its own advantage. They're still, you know, making efforts to. But I'd say the ultimate proof really is that after 34 years, the company still exists. $4.5 billion this past year in revenues. The market value is on the stock market is over $20 billion. And it's got $6 billion of assets. No debt. The company is in fantastic shape. And despite the fact it's been brought to my attention many times in the past month or two here in Europe that Electronic Arts has been, voted the worst company in the world to work for, or the worst company in the world, period. I've never understood exactly why, how that got that reputation. I don't know who it's disappointing so much, because its stockholders are very happy. It was always a great place to work. Yes, you had to work hard and long hours, had to meet deadlines, and that meant working way over time many times during the year. But it was also a joyous place to work. And when I go back about two or three times a year, I'll have somebody, some celebrity type or important person come into the Bay Area who would love to have a tour of Electronic Arts. So I go give them a tour. And actually, I have to, you know, call up Larry and say, you know, would you have your assistant arrange this for us? And so when I'm there, I talk with employees, current employees at Electronic Arts, and I don't get any feedback from them other than the fact that they are still just delighted to be there. It's a great place to be. It's a great place to work. They love their job. They love what they're doing. I don't know where Electronic Arts picked up that bad reputation, but it did at some point, and I still hear about it a lot. But anyway, that's my summary of sort of the what I lived through in the progression of and decline of Atari, and then the buildup of Electronic Arts. And I want to thank you for your attention all this time. I know it's been long-winded, but I hope it had some tidbits of information that can end up being feeling interesting to you. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Jeff. And I'm pretty sure we have some questions for Jeff, do we?
Happy to answer, yeah.
Anybody has any question for him?
Somebody must have a question. Yikes. Yes, sir.
I have a question. You're saying that EA is doing so well. How come if there were so many internet companies like Zynga and the others that used internet very well, and EA was still able to do this kind of profits and this kind of, and has this kind of market valuation? Why? Where does it come from? What are the main revenues for EA Sports, and how does it defend against the newcomers?
Good question. Its valuation is not all that great. I mean, when you look at the valuations on Wall Street, five times revenues is not a huge valuation. I'd have to go look, but I think, you know, companies like Apple and some others have, you know, hundreds of times their revenues as their valuation. But I don't know exactly how Electronic Arts is making $4.5 billion in sales, except for the fact that it's got these great franchise titles that keep coming out each year and need to in order to keep up with the changes in teams, sports teams, like Madden football and FIFA football, and variations on those kinds of things, so that people will continue to buy a new version every single year. So that's a great cash generator for them, or a great revenue generator for them, and it keeps their profits high too. I think that there is still a lot of optimism in the investment community that Electronic Arts' financials are very strong. If anybody can figure out how to eventually take advantage of the and make a lot of money off the internet, Electronic Arts is in a good position to do that. They've certainly bought a lot of companies that are trying to have companies that can produce, that do produce software for the internet, and they've shown some growth, but they're not the major part of the business still. So they haven't really broken out of their former role and with the internet. I can imagine that there are things in work, and I don't know this, but you know, I would say that virtual reality games are going to become probably pretty popular in the next year or two. I'm sure that Electronic Arts has some great research and development up its sleeve to position it well in the future of what's going on with virtual reality and augmented reality. So I think there's a lot in store. And as I said, for personalizing the games, I might even play myself. When I was in Poland, people asked me, one group that I visited asked me to play FIFA football against one of their best players. I had never played FIFA football. So I had to sit down and say, okay, now what do you do? How do you control these players? It was a game that was developed after I'd gone, and I never got around to dealing with it, and so I don't know what all going on in Electronic Arts, but I do think I have the confidence that there's plenty of smart people there that can figure out how to keep them alive, especially with the new technologies.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Do you see a disruption coming to your industry in the near future? Is this connected to VR or augmented reality? Is there a startup going to disrupt the whole industry?
No. I don't think so. Maybe the way startups are evolving now, what was the name of the company that has the goggles? Oculus. If they'd stayed independent, they could have been considered a startup and maybe been able to do some disrupting, but now they're part of Facebook. So that was their exit, and it was a good one. And so now it'll be Facebook that is one of the leaders of a new age of gaming. And Samsung is another one that has produced, I don't know whether they bought a company or what, to find some headset and Sony has one and Microsoft has one. And so for VR and AR, I have not seen any startups that look like they have the potential to disrupt the entire industry. There certainly are some startups that have good development capabilities and can probably make a lot of money in this new wave of gaming, but I don't see anybody disrupting things. I don't know what model you could use as a publisher of VR, AR, or a developer that would be disruptive of what's going on right now. And the minute you disrupt, a big company would probably offer you enough money to make you want to sell. I see things like Snapchat, and I think, where is this coming from? It was a disruptive force, and of course the two guys the three guys that started it, they booted one of them out, were fraternity brothers of my son at Stanford. There was nothing special about them. They just had an idea about something, and it just took off virally. And they turned down, a $3 billion cash offer from whoever it was? I don't know, was it Yahoo or somebody like that? Thinking that they could get a $4 billion offer from some Chinese company, and yet they don't have anything now. They still haven't been purchased. They haven't had an exit. They don't make any money. I don't know what's going to happen with Snapchat. It could completely disappear as far as I'm concerned. So I don't know what the disruptive model would be for a video game company to be able to make a big difference in any future thing. Any other questions?
Yes. What would you say is EA Games' primary mission, maximizing profit or making quality games?
Woo! Main mission, I would say making quality games. And here's the reason I say that. Or making games that are worthy of it. I can never remember. Somebody tell me what the name of the company is, or the game.
Rockstar.
Thank you very much. I never remember Rockstar Games' name. But, they had this this title called Grand Theft Auto. And I think maybe a year or so ago, they released a new version of Grand Theft Auto, and they had pre-sold, before they ever released it, they'd pre-sold over $1 billion worth of Grand Theft Auto. Years ago, Electronic Arts was in discussion with Rockstar Games to buy them. And Larry, our chairman of the board, walked away from it saying, you know, we just don't want to have Electronic Arts be a publisher of that kind of violent, gratuitously gross, shoot 'em up product. That took away, if you will, that was an opportunity cost that we could have had, that EA could have had much more profit and much more revenue, much more hype if it had bought the Grand Theft Auto franchise. But they didn't, because the primary goal of Electronic Arts was just to amass more and more money. They wanted to maintain some integrity or some control or some feeling about, you know, what was appropriate for Electronic Arts to have. So I would say that was the best example I've seen in the last decade, that the company is interested in producing a certain kind of product, a certain quality of product. And even if certainly Grand Theft Auto has a lot of great graphics and all that stuff, but they're very offensive, if you ask me. As far as I've heard, never seen, there are pornography games too. Well, Electronic Arts isn't going to get into that. Even if it meant billions of dollars of revenues to them, they wouldn't do it. So based on those, I would say it's much more important to have great games than it is to make billions of more dollars. Does that answer your question? Yes.
Hello, I'm Gregor. Just one question. So we know that the power of the right mindset is very important. And in your personal life, not connected so much with the games and everything, what was your mindset that was very powerful to you, that got you a lot in return, and that you learned a lot from it? So what's the mindset that you would share with us? Thank you.
Good question. I would say that I felt like, and I know a lot of other founders of companies in the Bay Area feel like, that being extremely successful like Electronic Arts was, and therefore those of us that were founders became extremely successful financially, and we had a lot of hard times. It's always hard to do a startup. You always have miserable times, you have great times. But I feel like my sort of mindset was that I was extremely privileged to have the opportunity to participate in that process during that time. Sun Microsystems was just getting started at the same time Electronic Arts was. I knew Bill Gates. I knew Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak. It was a very close community, and still is in a lot of ways. But I felt really privileged to participate in it, and so I felt like I needed to give back in whatever way I could to the community itself. And what in so many cases that means is not becoming, in some cases it means becoming a philanthropist. You set up a family foundation and then give away money. But it seems to me that the more valuable, well, there's another way of giving back too, and that is to provide seed fund investing to other startup companies, give them a chance to try to make it, to provide advice and mentorship to young people to help them get through the hard times which they inevitably hit. That part of being privileged in that area carries with it a lot of responsibility too. So that was the mindset that I had, and what it turns out, I'd say I'm 66, and so I've been basically just helping young people figure out how to do companies for the last 25 years or so, I'd say that that ends up being giving me the best feeling. The most fulfilling thing that I can do is to help others try to reach their goals, and partly by supporting them both emotionally and financially, if I possibly can, because that gives me the best payback as well. I mean, again, another payback, but still, it's something that it's a mindset that I have that you need to give back to your community if the community has if as a result of being a part of it you became very successful and had a great career or life or whatever, so that's what I think. I know the whole community does that way too. It's sort of the ethic of Silicon Valley is to pass along the success if you can. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. It was great. I have a question. Would you share your vision about mobile gaming? Your vision.
My vision of mobile gaming?
Your opinion, and what do you think about the future of mobile gaming in terms, let's say, comparing to the conventional gaming on consoles and on PC? Does the mobile gaming even have a future?
Okay. Yes, I think it does. When it first came about, I thought, oh God, we're going back 25 years. In terms of technology, mindless mobile games to me, mobile games were just an anathema. I didn't want to see them. I thought, what after all of this long hard work that to get to the point where you can actually have realistic graphics and movement and sound, and all, why go to a mobile game? What can there possibly be? I've never played Angry Birds. I've never had any desire to play Angry Birds or Candy Crush. I can't imagine, but that's just my opinion. I'd say the positive side of that I can buy into is that these kinds of addictive, repetitious, dumb games on mobile phones are really bringing in a much greater audience to the whole genre of video gaming. And in the long run, I think that's a huge advantage. There's a phrase people talk about when you give, the first one is free, kind of, you feed an addict something free so that you can get them addicted. That's kind of the way mobile games strike me right now, is a way of sucking people into the idea of playing, of getting engaged in mobile applications, and therefore preparing them to go further and beyond and be able to get into the more sophisticated, what I consider the more sophisticated games. I can barely read my smartphone. I have to put my glasses on to read my smartphone. There's no way I want to play a video game on my smartphone. I'm not the masses anymore at all. I'm at the one far end of that, and so I think that's hard for me to I don't have a great vision of what mobile games can move into, but I'm sure there will be something that'll make them very, very interesting. Yeah, I don't know what it can be. I know that smartphone has a lot of potential that it hasn't realized yet. So it could be that part of that's going to be in the gaming area. I just don't know what it is. Maybe with sensors and things like that, you'll be able to really get into a game more realistically using the sensors in the phone. I don't know. But the screen is so small. Anything else? Yes.
with Electronic Arts, you actually, I say, you created something awesome and you had great impact on us. Many of us played, I suppose, your games. And that's great. And you also created other great things like Skydeck and so on. But let's say somebody wants to build a new EA, the EA of the future. And we have, let's say we have the vision, the mission. What would you, what would be your advice? What to do, where to do it, who to contact with? Any major advice, maybe?
Well, one of the first things that I usually tell people, and I think it's valid, and that is that you need to pull together a team. You can't do it by yourself. You need to pull together a team that shares your passion for whatever it is that you're planning to do and is smarter than you are. Because you want to get the most talented, smartest people together that you possibly can think of. If you have a vision for where you want to head, find the people that are, that are absolutely tops in every regard, every aspect of the company that you want to form, and go recruit them. You know, because a great team of brilliant people can always figure out a solution to a product problem, even if they have to ditch the product and start all over. A mediocre team of people that might have a great product in their hands can fail miserably because they just don't know how to deal with it right, you know? So you want to have a brilliant team, a talented team of people that can get along. I thought that the Electronic Arts group that we first put, that Trip pulled together, the first six people, I thought were fantastic. Well, two of them were kicked out in the first year. They had personality issues that just didn't fit into the way that it was that make the company succeed the best, and they were very negative, and you know, it just, but we didn't know that when we started. We tried to get the smartest and most talented people we could together, and where to do it, I don't know. I keep being intrigued by the incredible numbers in China. I'm just not familiar enough. We never did any business in China. I don't know much about their gaming culture, although I think it's massive. You know, when I found out that there are 125 cities in China with more than 1 million population, I thought, oh my God, I had no idea there were that many cities with over 1 million. There's like 11 cities in the US with more than 1 million population. So if that's just a big unknown to me, but I would say that certainly should be one of the things to consider as a place to do this kind of stuff. And they are certainly developing very, very fast. But that's not a great answer for you, but that's all I got. Oh, another question, yes.
You are six co-founder, but how do you maintain a great relationship with other co-founders?
Wait, I'm sorry. How do we keep great relations?
If you will start again, how will you keep great relationships with them? And
You have to find people that are very self-aware, that aren't so caught up in their own egos that they can't deal with other strong egos in a way that manages the situation, tensions and all that stuff. You have to be able to have some conflict in order to be creative. There's some creation involved with conflict too, but you have to be mature enough that you can get beyond that and still understand that what you're all trying to do is work toward a goal as a team, that the team wins, the individuals don't win. And that's something that is a is often difficult to put together, but people don't understand. You know, we're trained to believe that we can succeed on our own. But in a startup situation, that's just not possible. The only big win is when everybody wins together. And that's hard. It's hard to find people with that attitude. But man, that's what I would make sure that I did a little bit more digging next time before I started another company with six people. I'd try to find out what their personality types were more than I did this time. I was just interested in what they'd accomplished previously and figured, oh, well, we can deal with the personality stuff. Well, that's not always true. You know, and the unfun part is that you end up being a personnel manager more than anything else in a big corporation, and that's not so much fun. I didn't like it that much anyway. So is that it? Okay.
At this point, I'd like to say thank you very much, Jeff. We really appreciate you taking the time.
My pleasure. My pleasure, really. Thank you.
Yeah, that's fine. One final interview to do for the television.
Okay.